So I think this sermon is about the nature of our faith, kind of looking at it from a couple different angles and tying it into this idea that God has chosen us and appointed us to go and bear fruit. Also this idea of friendship with God. So Jesus is a friend. Those are kind of the themes, I suppose. But it's kind of an exploration of how I come to the faith myself. And maybe you'll find a space in there that feels like how you come to the faith as well. So let's take a moment for silent prayer that God might speak to us all. Jesus' name, amen. So my son Joshua has been working like all kinds of extra jobs because he was really keen on finally moving out. You know, he's 25 and moving into an apartment, which he did. I'm very proud of him. He's done a great job. However, he took the TV and he left his dog. What's that all about? So I decided I have to go get a TV. I haven't bought a TV forever. So I go to the store. I'm looking at TVs. I came home, a Samsung 65-inch curved QLED. Yeah, I know. I'm going to lock that puppy down when he comes over to visit. So I'm talking to the sales guy, and I said, my first TV that I can remember is probably when I was just 5 years old or so, living in Iowa City, Iowa, and it was an Admiral black and white. How many of you Admiral black and white out there? Yeah, exactly. So we watched every year The Wizard of Oz on that black and white TV. Now, you know, as soon as The Wicked Witch came on, I stopped watching. I was under a pillow, and the flying monkeys are in my nightmares forever. So I load up the TV, I'm doing the Netflix thing, and I see what? The Wizard of Oz. And I'm going to watch that and remember all those great days in Iowa City, Iowa, and see that moment where it goes from black and white to suddenly this gorgeous color. So it was really fun. I just loved watching it. So I thought I would use that today in the sermon. So you remember how it starts when she lands in that land on the other side and she sings that song as she goes down the Yellow Brick Road. We're off to see the wizard, the wonderful Wizard of Oz. First one she meets, of course, is the Scarecrow. Feel free to sing along if you remember the words. I could while away the hours conferring with the flowers, consulting with the rain. Da-da-da-da-da-da. And my head I'd be scratching, my thoughts were busy hatching, if I only had a brain. Lutherans bring their mind to the faith. We think about the faith. You might have heard it said, the Bible said it, I believe it. That's not a Lutheran statement, even though we believe what the Bible says. You might remember I've said before that one of the first conversations I have with the intern is I ask them if they've read the whole Bible. Molly has, so that's good. Intern Kyle had not, and neither had intern Anna, so I tell them, well, you're going to read the Bible. That's kind of important for a pastor and for parishioners. And then I say, but, you know, there are some parts of the Bible you only have to read once, and you never have to read it again. All those lists and numbers, the majority of Leviticus. I think Revelation, frankly, is something that I'm not even going to, you know, after you read it once. Some books you read all the time, like Charles Roloff. How many times have you read Romans? Hundreds. Because Lutherans have a particular way of looking at the scriptures. It's through this lens of grace. We believe that we're justified by grace apart from works of the law. And so we channel or funnel the whole scripture through that idea that we preach Christ crucified and Him alone. And so parts of the Bible we read again and again. The wonderful images and the dreams of the prophet Isaiah. On God's holy mountain. A feast of fat things for all people. And God will swallow up death forever. The ideas in Isaiah that say, if you invite the homeless poor into your home, then the sun will dawn on you. And you will be light shining in this world. We read the Gospels again and again to get to know Jesus more closely, to learn the stories of faith. So we bring our mind to the faith. which means we bring our doubts. And we're not afraid to dialogue between doubt and faith and question. We also recognize there are contradictions in the scriptures. We don't try and hide that or deny it, but rather we try to come to understand it and put it in some kind of historical context. So we do a dance with the scriptures as we look through the Lutheran lens. And then we have to readjust the way we think when certain things happen to us in our life, or perhaps as we grow older and closer to that time of departure. And so we look at the world, and we have to fit what we understand about God into the things that are happening in our world. The theologian Karl Barth of the last century said, you do it by having the Bible in one hand and the newspaper in the other, and you see how those two things intersect. So we think about the faith. And as Lutherans, we're not afraid to live with a certain amount of ambiguity. Are you a sinner or are you a saint? And we'll say, well, can we be both? Is it bread and wine or body and blood? I'm going to say it's both. I don't know. And so we bring a way of looking at the faith, not afraid to question. Well, you know who the next one is, the Tin Man? When a man's an empty kettle, he should be on his mettle, and yet I'm torn apart. Thank you. Just because I'm presuming that I could be a kind of human if I only had a heart. Well, if you've been around Calvary very long, you know that I come to the faith with a certain amount of emotion. And I don't know when that first started. You know, I remember back when I was in high school, like 14 years old, and we got the call when we were at the dinner table that my grandfather had been killed by a drunk driver. I had to go into the bathroom to cry because 14-year-old boys don't cry in front of other people. Well, I gave that up sometime in my 20s after a number of tragedies. But it's not about crying. It's about, as the Methodists say, your heart being strangely warmed as you're drawn into a relationship. Relationships have a certain amount of emotion to them. So my love for Jesus is expressed often through tears as I understand how deeply and dearly I am loved without merit, totally undeserving. And then Jesus will talk to me and say, don't do that to yourself, Phil. Don't you know I love you just like you are? And I'll continue to love you no matter what you do. So our hearts are drawn to this one who chose us and appointed us and sent us out to love in the same way that we've been loved. Now, if you're in relationship with a friend, you can occasionally disappoint that friend. But if you disappoint that friend again and again and again and again, the friendship is diminished and perhaps even disappears altogether. Here's the good news. I believe that God has an infinite capacity to be disappointed by us, an infinite capacity to forgive us, an infinite capacity to encourage us and call us to live differently. I have a prayer I do in the morning. It's got two parts. First part is, Lord, make me useful to you today. Let me see those opportunities to speak a word of grace and love. And I say, and help me to not grieve you. By that I mean, help me not to do those things that I know cause you pain, because you see how they hurt me or hurt others. Help me to live into this relationship of love and this friendship that goes on forever. And so my heart beats a little more quickly when I see God at work in the world and understand the nature of this love that's unconditional and overwhelming. I think my favorite character, though, is the lion, especially that big, long speech before they go in to see the wizard. And I wish I could remember all those things. But here, when they meet him in the forest. Life is sad, believe me, missy, when you're born to be a sissy without the vim and verve. But I could change my habits, never be scared of rabbits if I only had the nerve. He says Norive, doesn't he? Courage. It takes courage to be a Christian. By that I mean to live the life of love in a world that finds it easier to hate. Scripture says, what good is it if you only love those who love you? Even the Gentiles do that. We're called to love those who are in some ways unlovable. I'll have to paraphrase the prayer, but Mother Teresa had a prayer where she asked to see Jesus. She said, let me see you in the irritable and the resentful. Let me see you in the difficult. Let me see you in those who are challenging. It takes courage to be a Christian in a world of division, in a world of hate. And so we're called to live fully into the faith using our mind and our heart and letting our faith speak for us. Courage to make sacrifices. Courage to do acts of kindness that will affect another person's life. Courage to make choices that are difficult. Choices to stand up for someone who can't stand up for themselves. We heard a great story about a woman's dedication at the Synod Assembly. Her name was Virginia. She lived somewhere in West Texas. And she had a heart for the Briarwood Ministries, but she obviously was on very limited income. We heard the story from Matt, the interim director. He said, every month, not always the same day, but every month, I would get a check from this woman for $7. And it said on the check, love gift. He said, I began to look for those checks. I knew it wasn't a significant amount, but we're always operating right on the edge, always wondering if we're going to make payroll. So it came time for me to go on vacation. I went off on vacation. Before I got back, I got a phone call that she had died. When I got back in the office and I started to do the books, I realized that we were going to be $7 short. And then I found the check, even from beyond the grave. The widow's mite, giving out of a generous heart, making sacrifices for the sake of someone else. Takes courage to live your life as a Christian who loves. It's very easy to claim Christ and judge others and make your faith all about condemning people. That doesn't take any courage at all. It takes courage to love, especially those who don't love you. So we live our life of faith because we anticipate a future day. Somewhere over the rainbow, way up high, there's a land that I heard of once in a lullaby. Somewhere over the rainbow, skies are blue. The dreams that you dare to dream really do come true. That dream will come true. I have absolute confidence in that. Not a single doubt in my being. I doubt all kinds of other things. That dream will come true. Somewhere beyond this life, we will experience that place where our dreams, all our very best hopes and dreams, will finally be. be the reality that we live. And the God who exists beyond our knowing, the God whose infinite imagination created every living thing, who called the mountains up out of the deep and cast the stars into the heavens, that God beyond knowing will call us friend and stoop down and wipe away every tear from every eye once, for all, forever, somewhere over the rainbow. To that God be all glory, honor, and praise, now and always.